Let me introduce our panelists briefly. I'm going to start with Senator Taylor. Senator Larry Taylor represents Senate District 11, which comprised of Brazoria, Harris, and Galveston counties. He's a lifelong Texan raised in Friendswood, right down the road. He and his wife, Carrie, have three adult children and two grandchildren. I don't actually believe that, because I think you're, what, 37? Yeah. Senator Taylor served five terms in the Texas House before getting elected to the Senate in 2012. He serves as the chairman of the Senate Education Committee. He's a member of the Senate Finance Committee, the Business and Commerce Committee, the Higher Education Committee. I mean, he is a busy man, as he said earlier. He also is the co-chair of the Joint Interim Committee to study a coastal barrier system, referred to as the coastal spine, aimed at identifying methods of storm surge protection. Finally, Senator Taylor has also been appointed to the Legislative Budget Board, which is a very important committee that provides recommendations and policy recommendations for legislative appropriations. Now, Charles mentioned earlier that he is also, one of his hobbies is being a tanker surfer, and I actually think we have a clip to show, do we? Who said our ship channel wasn't safe, right? Well, welcome, Senator Taylor. Our next panelist is Kathleen Hartnett White. Kathleen White joined the Texas Public Policy Foundation in 2008, prior to joining TPPF. She served as chairwoman and commissioner of the Texas Commission on Environmental Quality. And as y'all know, that's the agency that regulates environmental policy. It is the second largest environmental regulatory agency in the world, with over 3,000 employees, and they do an incredible job. And it is much of the success that agency has had in trying to help and accommodate business growth and industry is really dedicated to a lot of the work that Kathleen put into it during her tenure there. Kathleen now sits on the Texas Emissions Reduction Advisory Board. Her writings have appeared in numerous publications, newspapers, and she has co-authored a book called Fueling Freedom, Exposing the Mad War of Energy, published on energy, which was published in 2016. And these bios are all, there's bios, extensive bios on each of these panelists in your programs, but I just want to hit some of the highlights. Kathleen received her bachelor cum laude and master's degree from Stanford University and studied law at Texas Tech University. So, go Raiders, right? She and her husband, Beau, an unusual story, but really wonderful. She and her husband, Beau, are longtime breeders of national champion Jack Russell Terriers. So for you dog lovers, she can bend your ear a little bit about some of those things. So welcome, Kathleen Hartnett White. Our last panelist is Brian Zumwalt, who probably came the furthest to be here. Brian comes to us from Washington, D.C. He is the Vice President of Federal Affairs for the American Chemistry Council, so our national counterpart, and they do an incredible job. Prior to joining ACC in 2015, Brian served as Senior Energy and Environmental Advisor to Senator David Vitter of Louisiana, and as Chief Counsel for the Committees on Environmental and Public Works and the Committee on Small Business and Entrepreneurship. Brian holds a Bachelor of Science in Business from the University of Idaho and a Juris Doctorate from Case Western Reserve University out of Cleveland, Ohio. He's married and has two young children, Colton and Aiden. Brian is an avid hunter and fisherman, and for those of you that were here yesterday for the presenter, I can assure you he does not support catch and release for mosquitoes. Thank you again, panelists, for being here. Really appreciate you taking the time. We're going to dive right into a few topics, and I'll try to start questions to specific panelists, and then we'll expand and let others comment. The first thing we want to talk about is the Environmental Protection Agency's under the new administration, and I'm going to start with you, Brian. How do you think the EPA under President Trump's administration has impacted industry investment in the United States?
Hector, thanks. And let me open by a couple comments on the chemical industry before I speak directly to the regulatory actions coming out of the CPA. First of all, as you're well aware, Hector, the chemical industry is riding a wave of significant investment over the last 5+ years. And I think if you look back to 2010, we've had 333 projects announced across the United States representing a cumulative investment impact of $202 billion. That is wholly the result of abundant natural gas here in the United States. It's a result of the low cost, the resources we have available to us, and the significant impact in terms of being able to harvest that resource via directional drilling and hydraulic fracturing technologies. The first big shift we saw when the Trump administration came in, the Trump EPA came in, was a move away from a previous administration that focused very aggressively on undermining or over-regulating hydraulic fracturing and natural gas production here in the U.S. They were not friendly at all. Shifting to an administration now that recognizes the importance of natural gas production, recognizes the importance of the economic impact it's had, not just to chemical manufacturing, but manufacturing writ large across the United States. So that shift has been fundamental and is definitely pro-investment. The other difference we're seeing is right out of the gate, the administration took an aggressive approach to rolling back some of the regulatory actions that were definitely a barrier, if best case scenario, a wet blanket on investment here in the United States. And some of those regulations you're aware of, Clean Power Plan, Risk Management Plan, Waters of the United States rule, trying to expand the jurisdiction of what constitutes water of the United States governed by the federal government, as well as a handful of other regulatory actions. They also worked to and are in the process of streamlining air permits, which I know that Dr. White can speak to as well, but attempting to streamline the permitting process so investment can get in the ground quicker, people can get working quicker, which is fantastic. I'd also note that in rolling back those rules, they've also taken a couple additional actions that I think are critically important, and again, Dr. White's work goes back, and she's very much aware of the historical actions EPA has taken to get creative, for lack of a better word, with how they do cost-benefit analysis and how they provide the scientific underpinnings for regulatory action. I think there's two rules that are forthcoming that the Trump EPA is working on that could have a dramatic and significant impact long-term in terms of investment here in the United States. One is again, the reforms to how the agency handles cost-benefit analysis, making it more transparent, as well as also what type of scientific research they use when that scientific research underpins a major regulatory rulemaking. So that's kind of really the difference we're seeing is the confidence that you have in the regulatory actions and the speeding up of the permit, streamlining of the permitting process.
And from that, Kathleen, from your experience at the agency, how do you feel that EPA and TCEQ, the relationship between EPA and the Texas Commission on Environmental Quality is today, has it improved under this administration?
I think it has dramatically improved. I might add part of what I think it will have ongoing value and to help to, with the state really is assigned most of the permitting work. And because of the extraordinary growth in the petrochemical industry, and I call it the shale revolution. There are many, but it changed the world. And at a time with a president that is very supportive, and really understands how when we get all the numbers on rate of economic growth and job creation and all of that, a big percentage of that is from all kinds of energy-related industries that are now soaring as a result of the shale revolution. I think another change that's occurred really has to do with people. And I don't know how many people are aware of some of our Texans that are in key decision-making places in EPA or about that. One is EPA has a number of different regions across the state, and that regional office is also very important in terms of the efficiency and time frame for permits and all of that. We have a fine Texan ahead of that, Ann Idsel. She is director, Region 5, of which Texas and I believe Louisiana is also a part of that. And that's a big change. We also have, as chairman of EPA Scientific Advisory Committee, doesn't make a committee that doesn't make a lot of headlines, but absolutely essential to what are the, you know, the final perimeters of regulations. And we have Chief Toxicologist from TCEQ, Michael Honeycutt, is chairman of that national committee, extremely influential. And I also think, as I reflect on the many, many years I've worked on this, there's more, aside from all the technicalities and complexity of a lot of permitting for major sources, there's more of a general policy, you might say, that we share now from with the federal government, the senior decision makers, and with Texas. I never thought that people in industry were the dirty villains of pollution. They were the people that fabricate, absolutely essential, thousands of different types of products across. And that sense of working totally within the law as a partner with industry rather than a dictator to industry is powerful when those things are shared. And I might add just really quickly, as I hear this word more and more often these days, a shout out to you all, to your industry, is something that I found a lot of environmental professionals or engineers within the energy industry really haven't noticed. And that is, someone called it, it's a very simple fact that's hard to understand how it has gone by the wayside, and that is, according to the World Health Organization, the United States, as an annual average, has achieved the cleanest air, if you will, of any place in the world. And that was not through good luck. Yes, it involved a lot of regulation, but dramatic reduction of air pollutants is now a reality. The what's often used as an indicator pollutant, fine particulate matter, 2.5 microns in diameter, to use that as an indicator, we, even within this very industry intense petrochemical region of Texas, we achieve, actually it's a stricter air quality standard for the World Health Organization than for EPA, but we exceed what the World Health Organization is called safe limits. It's really amazing. And I found in lots of settings like this, or one where there's maybe dedicated to more towards the environmental side of things than this conference, just haven't realized this. And it wouldn't be difficult. We had in the previous administration one of the administrators of EPA under the Obama administration is, to me, famous for saying, on a hot day in our cities, don't go outside. The air may kill you. That's the head of EPA, if that's a general perspective, right at the very time or within the period that that this country and Texas has made the greatest gains of all. Go to EPA's now new and improved website. I know Brian is very familiar with all this. I think it's called, you want to go to Our Nation's Air, and you see all these incredible statistics about how much, not by 10%, 5%, the six main pollutants regulated under the Federal Clean Air Act since early 1990s is now, as far as ambient concentrations, 78% lower. I mean, they're amazing. And you know, in my estimation, who achieved this is all of you engineers. The technology that's been developed and operational methods that's been developed were really, for the most part, about environmental engineers. This is the bright side, which to me is just amazing. Also, though, there's so much kind of in turbulence going on, things that are being challenged in the court, new rules, pulling back rules. It's hard sometimes, I think, for anybody to get their hands around and what is really, you know, being optimistic without really looking at the risks we have too as this huge change occurs. But I say congratulations because the engineers in this room and all of your colleagues had, I think, more to do with this environmental achievement than anything else.
Thank you, Kathleen. And As Kathleen said, as a result, we're seeing a lot of economic growth. So I want to shift, talk a little bit about the economic growth that we're seeing. As many of you all know, we've had an incredible opportunity as a result of hydrofracking technology that has really been a game changer. And as Cal Dooley with ACC often says, we went from one of the most expensive manufacturers of chemicals and plastics in the world to one of the cheapest manufacturers, and all of that was made possible through the feedstocks made available through natural gas. Since 2010, and many of y'all have heard me talk about some of these stats, our industry is tracking about 92 projects worth over $70 billion in the state of Texas. Those projects account for about 150 plus thousand additional jobs, both construction and permanent jobs, and will generate well over $1 billion in new state and local tax revenue. The important thing to note is that, you know, we're about half of those projects are complete now. There's about another 20% that are still under construction or going through that process, but 30% of those projects have been announced, but have yet not broken ground. And it is very critical that we seize the opportunity to be able to get these projects underway under our healthy environment, economic environment, and while the iron is hot, before the window closes. And so, Brian, you know, are you seeing that same growth across the country you alluded to? What type of growth are you seeing nationwide?
So, similar is a relative term, and I think Lieutenant Governor did a great job of kind of outlining how important Texas is to the national economy. But let's step back for a minute, and I'm glad our numbers are pretty close. You said $70 billion. I think we have $69 billion for the state of Texas. So I'm glad ACC and TCC are pretty close on our numbers.
We tend to exaggerate.
let's go back and break down those numbers. So $202 billion, 333 projects. Of those projects, about 70% or $140 billion are all placed throughout the Gulf Coast, or that investment is throughout the Gulf Coast. Of that, also of that $202 billion, $69 billion or $70 billion, 34% is in the state of Texas. So a full one-third of all chemical industry investments here in Texas. Of that 69 or 70, whatever it is, about $67 billion is in the Gulf Coast. Another $2 billion is probably distributed in other parts throughout the state of Texas. So that leaves you roughly a third, that other 30% of investment is that's dispersed throughout other regions of the United States. Again, it gets back to kind of how important natural gas is to us and the shale gas plays. So a lot of that investment is surrounding shale gas or around shale gas plays. So through West Virginia, Pennsylvania, Ohio. And look, at the end of the day, the economic numbers that we're seeing, the unemployment rates, the consumer confidence, business confidence, the chemical industry can't take credit for that, but I'd like to say that we are an important factor in terms of its influence throughout the United States.
Awesome. And Senator Taylor, a lot of this growth in Texas is happening in your district. You represent the Ship Channel communities, which has a tremendous impact on the local economies of our cities and our counties that you represent. What are you seeing the impact on the local economy? And more importantly, how is that going to impact our education policy to make sure that we have a skilled workforce to fill the jobs that are in demand?
Well, if I could real quick piggyback on what they've said.
Yeah.
You know, the importance of Texas, I think the Lieutenant Governor also touched on this. But during that last recession, this state, for several years, created more jobs than the whole rest of the country combined. So it helped lessen the impact for the whole country. And then even with our own state, when oil prices dropped, it actually, the manufacturing sector here in this area went up because the fuel costs went down, as you said. But also, along with Kathleen was talking about, we continued to clean our air and water more than any other state while we were growing, which means there are reasonable regulations that if you work with your industry partners, that you can do things to improve things while you're still growing, whereas some states think the only way to clean things up is to shut it down. And obviously we don't do that here in Texas. As far as the economic impact on this area, obviously it's been a great boon for this area and for Texas. It's been a great thing for our budget, but it has caused it's shown us in some areas to be short, particularly in workforce. We found that out a number of years ago. We've had some discussion already. Y'all are all aware of House Bill 5. We've made efforts towards that. But if you just look at along the same time as we're doing all this expansion and growth here, the world is also changing. We're now well into the 21st century. We're now well into global competition. And we are now competing all over the world for the jobs and for the industry to move here and provide those jobs. And so the challenge has been trying to get enough workforce that's trained and ready to go to work in these plants, as well as in the 21st century. And we are a bit behind there. So we're in a transitional phase, but there are things we're doing even now in the legislature to prepare. If you look at our state, we have a great state. It's a great big state. It's a very diverse state, but our demographics have changed. And right now, our lower income demographic is now our largest demographic, and it's also our fastest growing. 6% of our population. And that has historically been our most undereducated segment of the population. In fact, the most accurate predictor of educational outcomes, if you're lower income, your educational outcomes aren't usually as good. But we've got to change that. And that's our challenge, is how to flip that. So that's what I've been working on, that I really have a passion for, is to making sure that all of our students have these opportunities to get that type of education. 95% of the jobs that came out of this most recent recession went to people who have some post-secondary, something beyond high school. Whether it's an associate's degree, a credential, or a college degree, 95% of the jobs went to those people. So the old days of, you know, having people work in assembly line and in the rural areas working on farms, that is becoming less and less of a possibility for this generation of folks going through school today. In fact, what they will be working on as an industry, we don't even know what it is. So educating those kids today, you can't teach them skills just for today. We have to teach these kids today how to learn and continue to learn for the rest of their lives. Our local schools have jumped in with career tech. Our community colleges are working with them. Our universities are working trying to get more people in the post-secondary with degrees. Excuse me, and frankly coordinating our efforts, because for many years we were in these silos. Industry was over here, high school, community college, and colleges were all these different silos. We kind of worked together, but even things like dual credit, the fact that you take credits in high school or community college, they ought to transfer, and we've had some issues with that. So we're trying to streamline all these things. Our goal is by the year 2030, which is now 12 years from now, and this goal was set in 2015, our goal, well, thank you, can I have some salad with that? Our goal by the year 2030 is to have 60% of our adults, 25 to 34, have some post-secondary credentials or something. That sounds 60%. Our current number today, after being in this system for this goal for 3 years, is 40%. Okay, so you see the urgency of what I'm talking about. We have to make changes today to make sure that that happens. Otherwise, Texas will not be the great state it is today in the very near future. So this is our goal, and we all need to join together to make sure that that happens. And there are things we could do. We know there's ways of educating and streamlining, and sometimes you get some pushback from certain institutions and groups, but we as a state need to band together to make sure these things happen, to make sure these students have the opportunities, that one, that they deserve, two, that as a state we want them to have so we can continue to be the great leader that we are.
Well, and I'll add to that, that the Lieutenant Governor asked me, so what can we do to improve upon the education policy to make sure that it's working the way we intended? And my suggestion to him was, come down here to the Ship Channel and look at the collaboration with industry, our community colleges and junior colleges, our public school systems, and all of our school districts. It is a model for the state, and quite honestly, a model for the country, to see how important. I often try to tell legislative leaders that our industry and other Texas employers are the customers of our education system in our state. We want to be able to take all these students, get them graduated, get them educated, get them trained, and get them to work. And so thank you for all the leadership that you provided there. You've also been a champion, as we talk about with all this growth and all the expansion we're having. We had a little interruption last year by the name of Hurricane Harvey. that came to visit. And obviously it impacted the entire Texas coast, which was, you know, very unusual with all the growth that we have going on. The timing wasn't great. I know that Harvey was a rain event in this area more than it was a wind event, but you've been a champion for the Coastal Spine Initiative. Where are we at with that project, and what can this group here do to help advance the effort?
Well, where we're at, you know, as bad as Harvey was, it was a precursor or a preview of what a storm surge could mean to this area. And it was a rain event, and primarily it was concentrated in residential areas. Versus a coastal storm surge, like with a hurricane, coming up Galveston Bay, which is a shallow body of water, you would have had that same effect on the residential, plus you would have had the impact on the industrial. In fact, the Houston Ship Channel was closed for about 4 to 7 days. Gas prices went up 80 cents on the East Coast and stayed that way for a while. So Harvey has been a good reminder of how important this area is to the country. When you look at things like, I believe 60% of our nation's military aviation fuel is produced in this region, the coastal barrier is becoming even more important. And frankly, we've had a lot of progress in the last year. The Army Corps of Engineers, I believe next month, is going to come out with their preferred plan so we can actually start working on design and that type of thing. And probably even a greater impact was that we did actually get $4 billion. Unfortunately, it's on the ends of the coastal barrier. We've been talking about from, you know, Beaumont to Freeport. We've got $4 billion now to help improve the levees and stuff on both ends of it. Now we need to create a local sponsor to help manage those projects. You have to have a local sponsor to get those federal projects and that federal money coming in. So we will be working on that again next session, which we tried last session to get that put together. But we're already working, putting the groups together to make sure we do have an organized local sponsor. Because if we don't take care of that $4 billion that they've offered to us, good luck getting the rest of it. So it's very important that we handle this properly and get it done. And that goes off the total price tag of the coastal barrier we've been talking about, because that's part of what we've been, the whole region is what we've been talking about to take care of. So having that done gives us great strides towards getting the next part, which is the central part, which is a swinging gate or some type of a gate system. What is a swinging gate? Over the ship channel. Free flow of water in and out normally, but when the storm is coming, you close the gate and you stop the storm surge at the coastline. This is one of those things that's going to change the trajectory of our history for this region, and frankly for the state, and possibly the country. If you think back to 1900, most of you may not know this, Galveston was the major city along the Gulf Coast. It was the Wall Street of the Gulf Coast. It was the largest city in Texas until the 1900 storm. And then things obviously changed after that. They came back and built the seawall, which is still doing its job today, but Galveston has never been where it was then. That could happen today, folks. As fluid as things are, as much as companies are moving internationally and nationally, if we really got wiped out here, there's a good possibility some of these companies could reinvest capital and put them other ways rather than rebuilding here. So we need to make sure we get this done, and we need to get it done as soon as possible. Our congressional partners, I think Trump working on infrastructure is all timed very well. I think we have our best opportunity this next year to make this project happen and get started on that project. So I'm very encouraged, but we can't let up on the pressure on this deal. We've got to get this done. And frankly, the best thing you can do in this audience to help make this happen is you all work with companies who have either customers or other locations or your operations or other parts of the country. Let those folks know, to let their congressional people know how important this coastal barrier is to them. Because I guarantee if we shut down these manufacturing facilities here, we're also going to be shutting down manufacturing facilities across the country because their feedstock is coming here, from here. So this is something that needs to happen. This year, I think, is very critical for us. We're now a number of years since 10 years. Harvey's going to start fading. We've already got North Carolina. We tend to lose the news once they move on to the next storm. This year is very critical. We've got to make that effort to get it done this year.
Well, I really appreciate the leadership you've shown. I also want to recognize that all of our local ship channel mayors have been champions on this issue. Mayor Bechtel, Morgan's Point, thank you for your outstanding leadership. Mayor Bechtel's gone with us to D.C. and pushed and prodded and, you know, wrangled everybody he sees promoting a Coastal Spine Initiative. They're committed to protecting our communities and our people, and so I think it is important. But also want to recognize the work of Bob Mitchell with BAHEP and Chad Burke, Economic Alliance, all championing this effort to find a solution that works for everyone along the coast. There are some sensitivities, and we need to make sure that we do that in a positive way. So thanks for that. Let me turn back to you, Kathleen. You have been involved as a policy thinker and a leader for many years. What do you see on the horizon as it relates to environmental policy that we need to be aware of?
A couple things, and one I intended to mention when I first spoke. Most of the federal environmental laws, and certainly the Clean Air Act, delegate all kinds of authority to the states. And this, again, this new administration is the first one in a long time that I think wants to really push that. And that things don't happen by themselves. We still need to remind and work with our federal partners. But so one size doesn't fit all, and whether you're an elaborate project like the Coastal Spine or one permit, we should, I think, really engage with the federal authorities, remind them of the authority which is the states. The previous administration, give you an example. How many in this room know what the acronym FIP means? FIP or SIP? Oh, I wish I'd be kind of nice if I could. we used to talk about SIP world. That's when, I'm sure there are some people in this room realizes the extent to which this area has valiantly dealt with ozone issues. Anybody? I think maybe that was an earlier point in time. In a nutshell, if EPA designates certain areas or regions as non-attainment from any of the six main pollutants regulated by law, they pretty much take over and put a cap on any new projects, and I won't even go into it. It's a very onerous kind of designation, and EPA has the driving authority. I spoke about six main pollutants, and for these national standards, they must be reviewed every 5 years. And there's over the many years that these programs have developed at EPA, you wouldn't believe how complicated. And you know, the SIP stands for State Implementation Plan. I think the last one I signed and sent to EPA was like 1,800 pages. So they do sometimes more harm than good because they're just chasing their tail on procedure, which brings me to a more specific response to your question. In this very mundane, the red tape issue, if you will, but all this new growth across the country, and much of it driven by the shale revolution, has to have a variety of permits and registrations and all that. The volume of them, I see perhaps the speed by which it takes to complete those is really going down in Texas. And I worry that you hear about people talking about inadequate pipeline capacity, which may be a serious problem for the oil and gas interests in the from the Permian Basin and others. But I think that's essential, that the TCEQ and other state agencies involved really try to figure out a way to shorten the amount of time it is taking them now to issue final permits so your facilities can be expanded or constructed and get on with it. That's also a problem at the federal level, which President Trump has addressed in a variety of executive orders, but it's complicated to do. And there are federal permits associated with some of these activities. Certainly the Coastal Spine would have all kinds of NEPA, we call them, National Environmental Policy Act. That act, over the last 25 years, has required permits that have taken 10 to 25 years before they're issued. That's just a range on the long end, not all of them like that. But you can't do business if you really have to wait 25 years. I know that the 25-year number jumps out because I was informed that
I don't know if anybody's been to LaGuardia Airport recently, but I think it looks like a developing country's airport and not economic giant that this state is. Took them, evidently they got their final permit, it was 25 years. And the amount of money that is spent from that, so these mundane, how long it takes to get your paperwork done at EPA or TCEQ or the Railroad Commission, I think is a, it's really it should be a front burner problem. The other thing is, again, with all of these, the change in the two administrations, there's lots of things in flux, and these state implementation plans for the national ambient air quality standards, there's a lot of things in flux, and so I think it's hard to even predict how it's going to turn out, but whether it's with our congressmen or whether it's with our state legislatures, I think all of the sort of environmental issues circling around now, whether they're reform or rescind or whatever, the opportunity we have is so precious right now. We really need to try to resolve those issues. And once again, like we've done on occasion in Texas, we had a win-win for the economy and the environment, and there was and no loss.
Brian, how about you? Are there one or two priority issues that ACC is looking at the federal level?
Yes, I don't know how interesting this is to everybody in the crowd here, but there's a couple things Congress does need to get done before the end of the year. The congressional session wraps up here with the looming elections in November. I think the House is planning on getting out of town next week if they can, if they can come to a finance agreement or a budget agreement to get them through the first week of December. And then the Senate is planning on sticking around till probably the second or third week of October to wrap up some additional nominees and get through some confirmations that I know that the Majority Leader McConnell would like to get done. One thing that we have that's big for the chemical industry, and I'm sure a number of people here are aware of, is something called the Chemical Facilities Anti-Terrorism and Security Act. CFATS needs to be reauthorized at the end of the year. I don't know if that'll end up being a new piece of legislation that was recently introduced by Senate Homeland Security. I just don't know if there's enough time on the congressional calendar or if it'll be some sort of reauthorization for X number of years that'll happen at the end of the year. In terms of big ticket items that we were very pleased with getting done in this previous Congress, tax reform was huge. I'm sure tax reform was huge for a number of companies here. The chemical industry had an effective tax rate, depending on kind of how the company was structured, somewhere between 25 and 32%. And the effective tax rate may be moved down to 21% was significant benefit to both investment, jobs, et cetera. As well as another component, the ability to repatriate foreign earnings and bring them back into the United States, finding a path where you could bring them back at a lower tax rate, that was extremely beneficial. I think one thing we would love to see next year, both the Clinton campaign and the Trump campaign had been committed to an infrastructure package. We are in dire need of infrastructure here in the United States. Along with this investment alone, you see the current stressors on our infrastructure. We had PricewaterhouseCoopers do an analysis for us back in 2016, and they assumed, based on all the investment we had in the chemical industry back in 2016, that by 2020, we would need an additional 1.8 million shipments a year in product, and that includes about 270,000 by rail, 730,000 by truck, and then another 800,000 by barge or marine. So we're in dire need of some, as a nation, in terms of some significant infrastructure investments. So that's something our fingers crossed Congress can get done in 2019-2020.
And Chairwoman LaGuardia really presented well yesterday about the needs for the Port of Houston. So all of our Texas ports are in need of attention to make sure that we can bring in the traffic. Senator Taylor, how about you at the state level? What are a couple of the legislative priorities, other than what we've talked about, that you foresee for the next legislature?
Well, for me, what I've been working on during this interim, School Finance Commission. It's been an undertaking we took on starting in January. We've been meeting regularly, monthly. There's three working groups. I was on two of the three working groups, so it's been nonstop. We've come up with some really good things through that process. You know, it's a very diverse group, so I think we have some real meaningful things we could do in education this session, having to do with finding, we talk about property taxes, obviously the School property tax is the biggest portion of that budget, of that tax. So whatever we can do there, we're talking about reallocating money, existing dollars to where we really need it. For example, I talked about the, you know, we have lower income and they call it comp ed, and there's a, you know, we give like 20% more per child that's considered low income based on the free and reduced lunch program. That program is probably not the best way to determine low income, but we'll work on that as well. But also the density of poverty makes a difference in educational outcomes. So we're looking at adjusting that rating, not just from 0.20, but from 0.22 to 0.25. And the higher number being based on districts that have a higher density of poverty. Because obviously if you have 80% low income, it's different than having 10%. So things along those lines to improve education, reallocate the dollars where we most need them to make sure we take care of this diverse population that we have to make sure that we can do those things. Secondly, you know, unfortunately, unexpectedly with Santa Fe in May, and I was also appointed chairing a committee on that. So we've been working on school safety, which includes infrastructure, personnel, whether it's, you know, counselors for intervention type mental counseling, more law enforcement presence on campuses. Obviously, that's something that schools have not considered in normal expenses. I mean, they've had some, but that's being beefed up all across the state, and that's something we need to look at and how to help in sourcing funds for that. So I think that's going to be a big issue. Obviously, the budget, every session is always the number one thing we have to do. We have to pass a balanced budget, and that'll be our challenge again. We have a good economy. Money is coming in, but there's already some challenges out there that are going to be costing additional money. But the good news is, as far as infrastructure, we have locked down with your help, passing a couple of constitutional amendments. We have money that's going to be a continuous source to help fund these transportation projects that we need, you know, desperately here in Texas. So I feel good about the transportation part. But education is, for me, it was a very busy session last session. I expect this to be also very intense again this session. But I think we're on the cusp of some great things.
Well, let me just say that the petrochemical industry really relies on the leadership of all three of you. Senator Taylor, you've been a champion for our industry for so many years, and the leadership you're demonstrating in education will ensure that we have the skilled workforce we're going to need, which is important to our public schools, our higher education community, and to industry. Brian, you've done some incredible work for our industry up in D.C. We're grateful for your support. And Kathleen, you've been a very open-minded, smart policy leader for our state, and have gotten a lot of accolades at the national level, so we greatly appreciate that. On a personal note, I just want to make mention of something. Last month we had the one-year anniversary of Hurricane Harvey, and I'm sure everyone in this room was just incredibly proud of the great leadership that we had from our governor down to our state operations center, down to our local elected officials, our county judge Ed Emmett, but all of the mayors, all of the police and law enforcement, emergency responders that did an outstanding job and represented Texas so well. And so we're really grateful for the incredible work that everyone did and the sacrifices that everyone made. But I do want to say our industry has been had a lot of attacks or criticisms after Hurricane Harvey that I think are really unfair. And I feel that people have taken advantage of a tragedy and tried to turn it into some type of a political effort. Let me tell you, Hurricane Harvey is the first storm that has impacted every industrial facility on the Texas coast. And every single one of these plants, the companies, the plant managers, and the people working in these plants work tirelessly to make sure that the people working there and the communities where they're operating were kept safe. And they did an incredible job. And I'm so proud to represent an industry for the incredible work they did and all of the work they did afterwards, helping their employees and helping their communities. And so just want to, you know, set the record straight there and say that I'm very proud of our industry and thank you for your leadership and all the things you do. With that, yeah. So with that, that concludes our panel.